Round of applause for Carlo Macchi.
Hello? Oh, great.
Welcome, Carlo.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you. So thank you very much. As mentioned, my colleague stole most of my beginning of my presentation with that nice introduction. But my name is Carlo Macchi. I am from San Diego, California. It's been a great trip so far. I always love coming to India. In particular, it was great today to be able to open the conference and the inauguration. So I'm very blessed and really appreciate the warm welcome that I've had thus far. So as mentioned, I work for DriveWealth. We're going to talk a bit about what we do toward the end of the presentation. But in general, what I'd like to start off with is we're very fortunate at DriveWealth to be able to travel the world and work with many fintech companies. Our colleague mentioned a few of the countries in China, Brazil, here in India, Chile, the US, and all over Europe. So I'd like to share with you a bit of the experiences we've had and share with you some of the trends that we're seeing in fintech globally and some of them that might be appearing here in India, or certainly that we've seen. So just a bit about my presentation style. I'm American, obviously, so I'm a little bit informal. I'll probably tell some stories, maybe a bad joke or two, so please bear with me as I go through this. But hopefully it'll be interactive, and certainly would love to entertain any questions as we go through the discussion. Let's see, always technical difficulties. This one? Ah, there we go. We're past the first big issue of the presentation. So just a bit of a background on myself. I've been doing this for close to 25 years. As mentioned, a few of the companies I've worked for in the past, including a startup company called NobleNet. For those who are technical in the audience, we ported RPC technology off of Unix to Windows. So for those who are non-technical in the audience, what that means is this was the technology that was the predecessor to what's now called Java. I've also worked at Thomson Reuters, who I saw some of my old colleagues downstairs at the booth, where I was a global business director. I worked at Thomson Reuters for almost 15 years, traveling the globe, working with some of their largest institutional clients, including BlackRock and Fidelity. Before joining DriveWealth, I worked at eSignal, where I ran a global trading business, a $44 million retail trading business. So as you see, I have experience both on the institutional business in fintech as well as on the retail side of fintech. I represent DriveWealth today. I've been with the company for just over a year now. It's a very exciting company in the US, focused on basically brokerage as a service. So we offer a B2B2C model through our technology and licenses to almost 400 million people around the world can get access to US investing here in India, China, Brazil, et cetera. So we'll talk a bit about that toward the end of the presentation. But for the purposes of, as you start to think of DriveWealth as basically the Intel inside of a computer. We are the technology that powers a lot of the fintech companies that are coming to market. So as we go through the discussion, I was thinking about how to frame the conversation, and it kind of popped into my head that I came to India, I guess almost 20 years ago to the month. And I was thinking about the presentation, and one of the themes I hope that you'll see through the presentation is about change. And the reality is, when you talk about innovation and fintech, it's all about change, right? Because without change, by definition, innovation is disruption and change. And it's hard for people to change, right? And I think it's important to recognize that things are changing all the time and things are changing. So I kind of had a surreal moment. I'll tell you a quick little story. I was thinking about the first time I came to India 20 years ago. You know, I was kind of an ignorant American. It was my first trip abroad, actually. It was a great trip. It actually changed my life, actually changed a lot of my personality. Since I went on that trip, I've been to over 50 different countries, both personally and professionally, so it was a huge impact. But people always ask me what it was like that first time I came to India, and I recall that there are three things that I primarily remember. One was the warmth of the people. It was a fantastic trip, and everyone was always very friendly to me. The second was the traffic, in particular in Delhi. And I was always astonished with how people could drive and get around. The traffic is much more substantial. And the third is obviously the food. I'm a big fan of Indian food. But as I flew into Bombay this time, I was thinking about the traffic in particular. And it struck me when I got off the plane this particular time that the last time, or the first time I was in India 20 years ago, I was the ignorant American who was negotiating over 20 rupees for a rickshaw, and I had trouble getting everywhere in the country. And this time, I was able to pick up my phone, and I use a very popular app now called Ola, right? So does everyone know what Ola is and use it here, right? Very popular. I'm sure it's changed many of the people's lives in this room as well. So for me, it really resonated practically how India has changed recently and certainly over the last 20 years. And I think we're going to talk a bit about this change going forward, both in India, around the world, and in the U.S. So in doing that, as I mentioned, I like to have a little fun in my presentations. And also, I've learned throughout my career that if I can bribe my audience to start off with an interactive session, I typically get their attention right away. So as mentioned, I'm from San Diego, California. I left on February 1st from my home. I arrived in Bombay on February 3rd. It was about 25 hours with layovers, etc., and approximately 8,792 miles. And for everyone who's paying attention to help with this problem of how big is the world, I actually flew from San Diego to London to Bombay. So as we talked about change, right, I believe that to understand change, you have to start thinking differently. To think about the future, you have to start approaching problems and things differently. So just a fun little exercise to get everyone thinking differently and stimulating some ideas. I'd like to ask people to raise their hand and maybe offer the answer to this question of how big is the world. And for the person who comes the closest to the answer, I'll give $20 US. So hopefully that'll be a lunch or something for someone for your participation. So I guess you use 5 rupees, so I'll use at least US currency from the US. So I guess the question is, does anybody want to guess how big is the world? 40,000, oh, you're switching from kilometers to miles just to throw me off. Okay, 40,000 kilometers. Anybody else? You can't just let him walk away with the prize without someone else. Sorry? Big as my brain. I hope it's a lot bigger than that. But that's probably a close guess. Anybody else before we give the answer? Come on, one more. We need at least 3 guesses. You can't be wrong, I assure you. Yes, please. Infinite. Okay, great. So, good guesses. Actually, believe it or not, oh, yes, please. 25,000 miles. So, 14,000 kilometers, 25,000 miles. The size of my brain. Endless, infinite. 20,000 miles. Okay, you didn't Google that, did you? I saw you with your phone, so you're excluded. So, believe it or not, the person who has won the $20 is the gentleman who guessed my brain. So actually, my brain is a bit smaller than 14 inches, probably more like 3 inches. But for the purpose of the conversation, I believe this is how big the world is today, right? It's as big as the mobile phone. You can reach anything in the world, not just with Ola, but literally everything in the world. And we'll talk about some of the fintech innovation. But this is reality. The world has become a very small place, right? So as we go through this presentation, and I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name. Here you go, Neil. Here, you won the $20, so big hand. Probably never, I almost killed myself. Thank you. Thank you for participating. So we're going to talk a bit about this change in perception and the change in reality.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, no worries. Thank you. So as I mentioned, change is all around us, right? So before I get into some specific fintech change, I want to talk about some of the changes around the world in technology with companies outside of fintech. So everyone can start to appreciate that, right? So Some of these names are very popular and everyone knows about them. I'll just pick a few out just to kind of set the context. But Amazon, I know, is they announced bad earnings here in India, actually. But don't worry, Mr. Bezos is a very creative guy and he always invests in regions, and he's making a big investment in India, and I think it's worthwhile. Certainly it's going to be a good competitive race with Snapdeal and Flipkart. But in addition to their e-com business, everyone is probably aware that Amazon is big into web services and hosting, probably the global leader. But in addition to that, they just launched a patent to actually have drones deliver their packages. So someday in the near future, much like Star Trek or Star Wars, drones will be coming to our doors delivering packages. That's a reality. That's the change that we're seeing. Google and Waymo, obviously the driverless car, it's up and running in San Francisco. You can see them all over the place. It will be a global phenomenon, changing the way we do things. Also at Amazon, they've announced a partnership with GE. So they're embedding Amazon into the refrigerator. So someday as your refrigerator empties, there'll be AI technology embedded, probably from Google, and you won't even have to order your groceries. They'll show up at your door based on the pattern that you've consumed goods in the past. So technology is here, right? And I think other industries are making tremendous leaps and bounds, and I think fintech in general has lagged what other industries have done, but I think we're poised to have some great excitement going forward, and we're going to talk a bit about that. You see a few of them on the screen here, some are local companies, including Snapdeal, who I mentioned, a competitor to Amazon. So obviously they've actually made some great strides in finance, actually ahead of Amazon with insurance. You can buy a yacht, obviously, as you guys know, do some brokerage services, et cetera. Paytm, obviously the largest investment in India last year, I believe, was Paytm. I think they're in trouble for using Mr. Modi's picture, was the last I read this morning, if I'm not mistaken. Even Money Control, right? CNBC of India, who's kind of a traditional media brand. You probably saw that they announced, I believe it was last week or the week before, a relationship with Kodak and Sharecon. So they're starting to bring in financial services. Two last ones I'll mention that are on the slide, but Amazon is going to be getting into financial services. They publicly announced that. For those who don't know, Jeff Bezos is from D.E. Shaw. So I think his commitment there will certainly make an impact on our community. So with all that said, I always think about what's driving these changes, right? So I guess I could probably write a book, actually, on what has caused a lot of this innovation and change. But the reality is it's either the technology or the culture. You either fall on one side of the fence or the other. Some debate that it's the Facebooks, the Googles, the Microsoft Windows of the world that have caused people to start thinking differently, gravitating to ease of use, lower cost items. Everything's at your fingertips, right? Everyone in our society today wants instant gratification. I was talking to Siddharth, I think last night, about his daughter using Snapchat, right? All the kids today, even the adults, right, we've become accustomed to now having everything at our fingertips. And that's not changing, right? I mean, we can debate this. I could probably put up a thesis of how McDonald's have actually impacted this change in how we all want things immediately at the click of our fingers. But I guess the point of this is it's here to stay, right? If anything, we're going to all have to deliver our services and solutions quicker, faster, regional, and globally at the touch of a button. So as we go through this and get into fintech, I'm going to highlight that. So we at DriveWealth have a vision of fintech, and I think this slide is going to scare a few people. Some people are going to view it as a partnering opportunity, and some people are going to think I'm a bit crazy for putting up this as the future of fintech. But here's the reality. We travel around the world, and this is the future of fintech. This is real. This is happening today. So traditional competitors, brokers, et cetera, they'll either be partnering with these firms or certainly competing on some levels. And we're going to talk a bit about that. But to really highlight the point that it's happening today, the second largest e-com provider in China has 250 million users, I believe, around there. So competitor to, say, Flipkart or Snapdeal, second competitor to Alibaba, they have launched trading in their platform. They're launching advisory services. Credit Ease also in China. has moved in that direction as a peer-to-peer lender, one of the largest robo-advisors or digital wealth providers in the world. We talked a bit about money control and what they're doing. I think they're going to expand as well. Snapchat, who's going public, just announced the other day they filed their paperwork. Does anybody know how much the valuation of Snapchat is estimated to be off the top of their heads? $3 billion. It's interesting. So I saw that in the Indian newspaper this morning, the Times. But in the U.S., they're reporting it's going to be actually $25 billion that they're expecting from the IPO. They've publicly announced that they're going to be building a digital advisor for Snapchat. So they'll be getting into financial services. I mentioned Amazon and their public desire. Google just hired about 100 engineers on their Google Finance team. So we anticipate them getting it. They had a project about 3 years ago with wealth advisory. So again, this is reality, and we have to think differently about that reality and try to figure out how we're going to participate in that market. So I wanted to talk about five of the trends that we're seeing around the world, and also wanted to highlight some of the innovators here in India, and there's quite a bit more in each of these categories. I'm just going to briefly talk about where they are today and just give you a brief description of where I think they're going to be in the near future. So digital wallets and payments, I think the most popular here is Paytm. There's many around the world, the Alipays, China Union Pays, obviously Apple Pay, MasterCard are very popular. The trend is everywhere in the globe. Currently, most of the wallet providers are really focused on retail, so buying consumer goods or paying your bills. We believe, and we've proven at DriveWealth, that that's going to change as these folks start to think about how they're going to broaden their product suites to new endeavors and new revenues. They're going to get into financial services, literally and figuratively, where the money is. The opportunity for them is to actually start funding some of the brokerage accounts. We've proven this with some of the Asian providers, but we anticipate the Paytms, Jillers, et cetera, of the world, you'll be able to open a brokerage account. So when Mr. Modi talks about India going digital, the impact in India, as you'll see later in the presentation, will be the opportunity to open a brokerage account on your phone in seconds. You won't have to go to a brokerage account, sit down with an individual, sign 50 or so pages, I think I've heard, is the signature process, and then wait 5 to 10 days just to open an account. It will all happen on that phone, and I think Paytm and the other wallet providers will be crucial to that. Robo-advisory, I just want to highlight that in China, so does everyone know what robo-advisory is? No? Okay. So just a real brief, the concept of wealth management, it's a digital version of that, right? So there's basically two versions, arguably, about robo-advisory. The digital wealth being that you've presented your digital offerings as a financial advisor with some research, et cetera, to portals, mobiles, websites. The other is a bit more complex, where you're actually adding technology to make the investment decisions for your clients. So you basically build a profile of your users based on them filling out a criteria online, and then the model that you've developed behind that will invest based on that criteria. And it's becoming very popular. I think it was pioneered in the US with Betterment and Wealthfront, but it's estimated to be arguably between $8 trillion business if you listen to some of the research from BI, or if you look at Capgemini, they actually estimate it's gonna be $13.5 trillion over the next by 2020. So I'm going to highlight this a bit because there's actually about 10 robo or wealth advisors here in India that I've talked to, and I'm sure there's more to come. In China, there's about 20. In Brazil, there's about 5 or 10. It's really becoming a very hot trend around the world. Digital banks, obviously, with the dispersity of India and the size of India, you can certainly appreciate the value of not having to get in a car and drive miles to a bank. Everything be done at a touch of a finger. Right now, digital banks are focused on savings and traditional investing. Their big value, again, is cost, ease of use, not having to travel. The other big value is from a cost perspective or a fee perspective, users benefit because you no longer have to pay these administration fees, which are actually one of the predominant ways banks have made money in the past. As an example, in the US, I think the banks made $11.5 billion were just in administration fees. And these folks eliminate that, as well as take advantage of technology so they can offer their brand to many different regions at the touch of a finger. In the future, we anticipate that digital banks will move out of just savings and traditional banking services, and much like the big conglomerates of the world, they'll start offering investing. So it'll be a one-stop shop for you to do your savings accounts, your insurance, your personal finance management, your wealth management, and your stock trading and investing in general. Likewise, peer-to-peer lending is also becoming quite big. I know it's there's a few established firms here in the States. I think in India, it's there's some regulation that may occur, and certainly in other countries, still to play out. I think it's fair to say that we feel that the peer-to-peer market will be regulated in most countries, and because of that, they're going to see a saturation of the lending space. But also what we see in many of these demographics or many of these segments is they're attracting retail users into their platform. So in the peer-to-peer lending space, I mentioned CreditEase earlier as the world's largest peer-to-peer lender who has introduced trading into their platform in U.S. investing. What they've recognized is, and it's a popular metric, it's 80% easier to upsell your client, right? Than 80% harder, if you will, to get new clients, right? There's a higher cost, a higher opportunity. All of these folks are bringing in retail consumers. So being able to offer investing into their platforms is a natural extension of their products, creates new revenue stream, and helps them leverage their existing customer base. Oops, I think I went one too far. And we talked a bit about the new financial players. Which are going to come up and change the market. And I guess just to highlight this, being able to go into a media site and actually take action. So if I'm reading an article on Reuters.com on the financial markets or money control on Apple and their earnings or HDFC and their earnings release that's coming out on Tuesday, and there's some projections of that their earnings are going to be positive, it might be an investment opportunity. I don't want to have to go to my broker. I want to be able to take action right then and there and execute a trade or make an investment in those particular securities. You can see this in different products like Snapchat or even Twitter, et cetera, being able to take action from the information that's shared at hand. So I want to talk a little bit about the robo digital wealth advisory market. It's probably one of the most popular trends in financial services and fintech that we come across from country to country. As I mentioned, it's a huge market, or projected to be a huge market, between $8 trillion and $13 trillion over the next 3 years. It's interesting to me, the robo market, when I think about India. I think the research that we read on India, and I think some of the facts are that right around 4%, 2-4% of Indians actually invest in the market today, which is considerable if you look at the size of India. But if you look at how it compares to other countries such as the US, close to 50% of people invest in the market. In China, it's upwards of 60%. In Brazil is growing, it's about 20% and growing. All of these countries are having more and more people invest in the market. And the reality is, we talked about, right, ease of access, easier to do, click of a button, right? It's now easier to get into these markets and invest. So I anticipate that in India that will continue. And if that's true, right? Think about this if it's true, right? Even if India gets to 10 or 20%, right, of population growth, I think the US has 670 million people and India is roughly 1.3 billion, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere around there, almost double. So if the growth rates continue, right, at 20 to 30% of Indians investing in the market that have never invested before, there's a huge opportunity for everybody in this room and everybody who's in this market. I'll give you a couple more stats on India, just to put this in perspective, especially when we think about financial services being on a phone and new devices and new instrumentation of the technology. Right now, 50% of Indians are under the age of 25. 65% are under the age of 35. The most interesting stat, I think, is that by the year 2020, the average age in India will be, does anybody know? 29, dead on, right? So I think about this generation of users. It's not that far away, right? These are our investors, and when we think about growth in this industry, these are the folks that we're going to have to get to, right, and talk to, educate, and participate in and meet their needs, right? They're our customers, they're our users. And I'm sure many of you have kids, right? You don't have the opportunity to talk to your kids, they're just using technology, texting all the time. So if I think about how are these folks gonna invest? We're seeing it today. They're not going into a wealth management shop, they're not going into a brokerage shop. They don't have the time or the patience to sit down with someone to have this conversation. Not to mention the more educated, right? They have more content than we ever did growing up. They know much more about financial services probably today than when I knew when I was 30 years old, 15 years ago or so. So they're looking for different opportunities. So I think the robo market is poised to take off in India and around the world. And we'll talk a bit about how DriveWealth participates in that. The last number I'll mention on the growth opportunity here before I get into where the market is today and where it's going from a robo standpoint, is that it's estimated there'll be $77 trillion in wealth transfer to this generation. These folks are gonna be getting money and be very wealthy. What are they gonna do with the money? You know, they might start their own businesses, but I think most of them are risk adverse if you read about millennials and what they're doing. So I think conservative investments and risk adverse investments through wealth management and diversification is gonna be the wave of the future. And I think this technology will be prevalent in years to come. So with that said, as I mentioned, Betterment and Wealthfront really led this innovation in the States from our perspective. They've become very successful. They carved out a nice niche. The first robo-advisors built their technology or their models on a very basic, I shouldn't say that, it's a very well-known business technology called Black-Scholes. If there are any traders in the audience, they probably know more than I would ever know about Black-Scholes, but certainly it's a methodology that's been around. Arguably, people have represented that it might have been the cause of the crash in 2008 and 87. But with all that said, these robo-advisors have followed traditional trading techniques today. They have been all digital thus far. They've certainly lowered the costs. Betterment and Wealthfront, I think, are at 25 basis points versus 50 basis points. And if you look at traditional wealth managers, anywhere around the world, it could be in the US, it's 2 to 4% of your fees that you pay as service fee. In other parts of the world, it's even higher than that that you pay out to your wealth managers. So 50 basis points is a considerable advantage for them from a price standpoint. Their primary driver has been to get these new investors and these millennials. So they've done a very good job of that. Betterment, about 60% of their client base is this millennial generation. But I think that's gonna change. So we'll talk about what's been transpiring, and I think this trend will continue in the robo-advisor space. In the United States, as Betterment and Wealthfront started to acquire these new types of clients, it drew the attention of the big players. So the Vanguards, the Schwabs, the LPLs, the traditional financial advisors in the US took note. They started to lose some of their clients. They also had a big concern because, as I mentioned, this transfer of wealth. How is a financial advisor gonna keep their clients and their wealth? They didn't have a way to talk to the family members. They didn't have a way to interact with them. So now you see all these big players starting to get into that space. So they're acquiring people. So I think I looked this morning and, or the other day, I think Betterment has roughly $3 billion in assets under management, if I'm not mistaken, Mike, somewhere around there. A little higher than that, probably $5 billion now. Vanguard, who just opened their wealth advisor from March to December last year, had over $17 billion under management as a big player, right? So they didn't just get the new players, they were able to move over existing wealth into the new book of business and offer it at a lower cost to folks who are willing to do that. So it sounds kind of crazy because they're kind of giving their money away. But the folks at Vanguard and Schwab and BlackRock and others who are getting into the space, they recognize that it's about upsell and cross-sell, right? The 80% rule I talked about earlier. So they want to keep you as a client, and then they're going to sell you other services, retirement services, health services, 401ks, mortgages, et cetera. So what's the trend that's going to continue going forward? Here in India, I think there's a lot of independent robo-advisors, and I think they'll continue to grow. In China, we see that as well. I do think that, well, I'm pretty confident that a lot of the bigger players are gonna start to get into this space. But it doesn't mean that those independent players are gonna go away. I think there's still gonna be a need. I think there's gonna be a need globally they're just going to be a little bit different, right? They're going to change their models from being Black Scholes. They're going to change their models from being mostly mutual fund investing, which is it is today. They'll start to offer RRAs, fixed income, insurance. We're actually talking to a few firms in Germany from a niche perspective where they'll start carving out the type of investments you do. So you might have a technology robo-advisor. The folks in Germany actually have a, it's kind of an interesting robo from my perspective. They allow you to invest based on your carbon footprint. So you can start to see the diversification of these models and still a market for smaller firms and the larger firms to compete across the board. As well, pricing models will change, right? Pricing models in financial services have been pretty much stagnant, I think, for the last, at least since I've been involved, for the last 25 years, right? So the assets under management model, we believe that these models will evolve. We certainly see a lot of people talking about subscription models, much like you get on Netflix, or you will get on Netflix here in India, or Amazon Prime, or your cable service, et cetera. So we think that's going to be a big innovation as well. So at the end of the day, I just wanted to bring this up to everyone because I think this will be a big impact in fintech over the next 3 to 5 years. And I think it's an area that we should all focus on and consider how we're going to be involved in this, either as a consumer or as a provider. So I mentioned earlier that I work for a fintech company in the States called DriveWealth. And I just want to talk a bit about what we're doing. At the beginning, I mentioned that we're kind of the Intel chip. We're the engine that powers a lot of these fintech companies. So I mentioned some of the innovation that's coming out, the robo-advisors, e-commerce getting into fintech, digital banking, some of the traditional brokers, peer-to-peer lending, even the digital wallets. In my opinion, what all these have in common is what DriveWealth provides. We provide them brokerage in a new way. So as you're a robo-advisor, you can create the prettiest interface, you can have the nicest model, you can do the nicest application process, you can have your niche, et cetera. But at the end of the day, you have to execute that trade. So brokers, no matter what asset classes they offer, are intrinsic to that business model going forward. E-commerce providers, as they start to offer these trading instruments again, the broker is the backbone that everyone forgets about, right? We're the Intel chip. It goes down the list, and I would argue that some of the local brokers, as they think about the growth in the local region, they're going to start thinking about offering other asset classes outside of India, right? So, and we'll talk a bit about why that's important and why they'll think about doing that. But what DriveWealth has done is we've actually flipped the broker-dealer model upside down. So what that means is we're a technology-first broker-dealer. So we have a full-service regulated broker-dealer license. But what we do is we offer all of broker services to a partner, a business-to-business partner, who can offer it to their consumer in 130 different countries so that they can open an account, trade on the account, clear on the account, report on the account. They can offer the digital services under their brand, on their phone, on their website, all through just coding to our APIs and leveraging our workflow. So instantaneously, you can get access to the US markets here in India, in China, in Brazil, anywhere, and it's fully legal, fully regulated. We've worked with Nishit Desai here in India, Will Mihale globally, to make sure that we're complying with all the local rules as well as the US rules. So it's a fantastic model. So as I talked about, the opportunity to offer new products through brokers or through new avenues, 80% rule, right? 80% easier to upsell your product. So DriveWealth can help you enable your firms to do that. We've actually partnered with SIC recently, a local broker in Bangalore and Mumbai, to prove the concept. So you can come by the booth and actually see a demo, and I'll give probably a 5-minute demo toward the end of the presentation, demonstrating what this looks like. But as I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, just to put this in perspective, today in India, when you open a brokerage account, it's my understanding it's a 50-page process, countless signatures, 5 to 10 days to get your money in the account. It's very difficult, right? With DriveWealth, as you'll see, and you can come by the booth, I think we're booth 15. We have the app from SIC that they're using our technology behind the scenes to demonstrate this. You can fill out an application completely online. The digital signature is online. I did it to prep for a demo two nights ago. It took me 5 minutes to fill out the application. Just click buttons, you're filling in, you know, A, B, and C, putting in your country ID, you can upload your pitcher ID. Within 5 minutes, you filled out your brokerage application. Within 24 hours, DriveWealth does all the background checks, all the AML, the approval process. So within 24 hours, you're able to open your account. Within minutes after that, you can actually fund your account. You can put it on a credit card, you can do a wire transfer, et cetera. No more waiting 2 weeks to trade. And it's all done through the digital device, mobile phone. You don't leave, you can do it in a cab, you can do it on the hall, you can do it from your home. I'll leave it at that for now. But pretty much anywhere. So it's really innovative technology. It really, as we talked about the changes in trying to meet the needs of the future, easy access, quick, at your fingertip. That's what DriveWealth provides to brokers like SIC, brokers around the world, but also to these new avenues. As I mentioned, JD.com, CreditEase, Alcanza, who's a robo-advisor in Chile, et cetera, 400 million users. So as I mentioned, DriveWealth is a new technology stack. This kind of highlights the portions of the stacks that we take care of. Ultimately, as a partner of DriveWealth, your responsibility is the marketing and distribution of the service to your customers, so upselling, cross-selling, or creating a new revenue stream for you. And then our technology, our licenses, our workflow, and our staff take care of the rest. Some areas that we focus on, obviously robo-advisory is a big push for us. We're the first broker that has actually serviced robo-advisories internationally. So we're talking to a lot of folks here in India. We've got a number up and running in China, Brazil, Chile, as I mentioned. We think this is going to be a big area going forward, as I mentioned, and love to talk to some folks here about that. Broker services, so again, cross-sell and upsell, diversification of a portfolio. Self-directed retail investing. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about this, but if you can think of the e-commerce site, you're buying Nike shoes on Flipkart. I want to now invest in Nike. I can do it at the click of a button through DriveWealth. We offer all these services to different varieties of segments, changing the world. In addition, from direct investing, I wanted to highlight one really interesting piece of technology and regulation that we've done. We're the only broker, as far as I know, in the world to be offer real-time fractional trading. Does anybody know what fractional trading is? Okay. So fractional trading is a new innovation. So the beauty of fractional trading is it's basically dollar-based investing. So you no longer think about investing in the market as I want to buy 10 shares of Google, right? I could have $100 in my pocket, and I can participate in an investment in Google now. So what DriveWealth enables you to do is to buy a percentage or a fraction of a stock. So why is this innovation so important, right? So we talked about this next generation of users. We talked about what people are doing. Talked about how do we get from 2% of Indians invested in the market, or 4%, to 20%, right? There's a trust level and a comfort level. Fractional trading helps people get into that investment. With $100 in your pocket, you can now participate in Amazon, Google. You can actually build a basket and spread, and I'll show a little demo of this, and spread that $100 in a risk-averse way across a number of investments, right? So pretty interesting. I think this is a game changer. Both here in India and around the world. So I know what a lot of people are saying, the folks that trade in the market and know the Indian market. Carlo, you're out of your mind. Have you seen a chart of the Sensex versus the Dow Jones? They kind of go in parallel, and India's, of course, avoided, fortunately, knock on wood, recession for, I think, since inception, if I'm not mistaken. Very profitable economy and very good with the stock market. I would suggest that if you take into account currency conversion, that you'd still actually make out if you think about the US markets time over time. But not to get into that debate, I think more importantly, from a US market standpoint, you offer a bit more, right? So it's our fiduciary responsibility as people in this industry to help people be successful in investing, right? It's in our best interest, it's in their interest to be successful, to have their investment grow. Happy customer, keeps growing, helps us all, the customer's happy, we're happy, et cetera. Diversification is the key to that. Right. So how do you diversify? You can certainly buy a mutual fund. You could buy an ETF, very popular in the U.S. You can, but then you can also buy mutual funds that have different asset classes like fixed income, et cetera. But a lot of people don't talk about global diversification. Most wealth managers, people experienced in this market, will insist that at minimum, you have 20% of your portfolio internationally to protect yourself. No one does that, right? And we've talked about that. It's hard, right? It's hard to get access. What DriveWealth enables you to do is to get access to the U.S. markets through these B2B partners that are here in India, right? Fantastic. So now you can make risk-averse investments and be safe and feel comfortable that your family's money is safe going forward. I think there's also an interesting trend that's happening with this next generation and even myself. People are gravitating toward brands, right? I think we could get into a long discussion about this, but more people today don't do research. When I first got into investing, I used to look at, I used to look at a lot of things, stochastics and Bollinger Bands, PE ratios, balance sheets, used to compare them. I used to use Advanced Get, if anybody knows about Elliott Waves. I used to use that for trading, right? So very complicated, investing was hard. Today's society, no one likes hard, right? No one's gonna, go do a lot of research on their investment. Well, very few people, I shouldn't say nobody, that's not fair. But I think more people that get into investing, the more mainstream it becomes, the more we see people investing in what they know. I buy Nike shoes, I wanna invest in Nike, right? True. I go to ICICI Bank. They're a great bank, I see them everywhere, they're huge. I'm gonna go buy ICICI, traded on NYSE, by the way. I travel on, there's a new, what is it called? The Ola, yeah, but the new plane, the booking service? Make my trip, right? I use that service, so I'm gonna start investing in that service, right? That's what people are going to. Fortunately or unfortunately, a lot of those brands are in the US. Right, the iconic brands are in the U.S. markets. So people, as they get into investing, they want to recognize those brands and invest. This is a trend. This isn't me saying this selfishly, but this is the reality of the world, right? We all experience it every day. I'd also point out that the U.S. market is probably considered the most stable and trusted in the world, highly regulated. So I think people feel safe with their money. So as we talk about culture, and I think in India in particular, right, where you've got 2 to 4% investing, I think there's a lot of fear of investing in the markets, right? That's changing, fortunately. But I think going forward, when they try to mitigate that risk, that fear they have, buying the brands that they know, seeing the size of the companies, the Amazons of the world, but also knowing that the markets they're invested in have been stable, regulated, and trusted, and the variety, right? You've got 26,000 companies across the U.S. exchanges. The diversity to invest is mind-boggling. So these are just a few of our partners. As I mentioned, SIC is downstairs at booth 15, so you can actually see their integration in the platform. And just a few more customers, I think. And I was gonna give a demo, but I think I've run over. So just come down to booth 15, and I'll gladly show you a demo. I'll show you the whole 5-minute login process. I'll show you the app. It's designed for the phone. Everything's drag and drop, double click. You'll be able to invest. Literally, I can show you investing in a basket of stocks in about 3 minutes. So I think it's fascinating. I think you guys will be kind of blown away to see what's coming in trading coming forward. So I appreciate the welcome, and I always love coming to India. So thank you again for your time. So like a digital wallet, as I mentioned. And then lastly, with the credit card, you just have to pay your credit card fees and they do the conversion for you. But it is in US dollars.
So we need RBI permission for that?
No, so we've worked with, as I mentioned, the legal folks here so that the process has already been approved. So the way it works on the phone and the mobile devices is pretty seamless. You do have to track, though, the amount of money that you move outside the country per RBI. There's a limit of $250,000 US. So that is the user's responsibility to lawfully put that on your taxes and claim that as investments outside.
One more question here.
Yeah, of course.
You said that you work with which organization here for the purpose of U.S. investing?
Yeah, so far we work at SIC Global, Booth 15. They're I think they're most known for CSB, Colonel's Broker's House, so based in Bangalore. But we're talking to a number of other firms to offer the service. We just went live in India late last year, so we've got a lot of conversations going on to bring this technology to a lot more firms in India, and would welcome any of those conversations.
I saw that you have angel broking as your...
I think that was just an example in one of the slides, that going forward, folks like Angel or ICICI or Snapdeal Flipkart, we believe that they'll start to look at other
markets.
They are
using your technology?
Not today.
Not today.
But we're hoping to meet with them.
See, right now...
Where are they?
They have tied up in the way... I was just trying to analyze that point.
Yeah, currently we're not working with Angel, but we have a number of meetings over the next 10 days with different brokers and different, let's call it, new types of partners. So we're hoping to have a lot more options.
I think we'll be needing more clarity on this investing in dollar terms, because in RBI, taking approval from RBI, even though there are limits, in India the process is very cumbersome. So unless the investors are slightly educated, the moment the word RBI comes in, people scare away.
Yeah, so what we can do is we can put together a legal document that we can publish to the users, so that you can understand and feel comfortable with the process, so we can make it a step-by-step guide so that you understand.
I can only share with you that in India we have mutual funds which offer this facility of U.S. Investing in stocks, but they are fund of funds. So the cost element is very high for investing, and we don't know the efficiency and the capability of the fund manager to track U.S. markets. So this will be a very good asset allocation.
Thank you. Yes, I think it'll be fantastic to have more.
Yes,
partners.
Carlo, you.
I think there was one more.
Yeah, two more questions.
Sorry.
I'll come to you.
Yeah, Carlo.
Yes.
In India, we even with the most stable, most safe investment, that's a fixed deposit, we probably look at about 7.5-8% returns. So why would we, when it is so safe here, look at investing in the U.S. for what kind of returns?
First off, I think the U.S. market you'll find to be very similar. I think year over year, with the exception of a few years, it's around 8%, right, arguably. And I don't mean to be snarky, I guess is the term we use in the U.S., or rude, but I understand that the markets have continued to grow here, but unfortunately, the world is not a stable place, right? I would argue back in, you know, was it 2008 in the States, we were all very happy and healthy and wealthy, right? And we had some misfortunes, right? And the world is not predictable, unfortunately, for many reasons. And I think, again, the idea is not to get out of the Indian markets. I think it's a very good investment, and I would never argue that point. But I would suggest, just as an investment for myself, diversification is always best for your portfolio. So I guess my point is, you could probably see similar returns. You get a wider variety of types of stocks that you can invest in, name brands you know, who grow much more than 7%, as most technology companies do in the States, like Facebook, Snapchat, I'm sure will be a great gain. But most importantly, it's the diversification aspect that I would consider as an investor. Just my personal opinion. But I certainly appreciate the success in India.
One last question for Carlo.
Sir, what would be the cost advantage, or how would you put it in terms of the costing in terms of fund of funds or directly?
Okay, good question. I'm sorry I didn't mention that. So I think based on the gentleman's comment there, you might fall off your chair. So to buy a U.S. stock, any amount of shares, right now with SIC, again, our partners offer this, you can buy any number of shares for $2.99 for that particular trade. For a fractional trade, which is under one share, it costs 99 cents. And will I spoil your announcement? Or? So we're also, SIC is coming to market with a subscription model. So you can pay, I think we're talking about $9.99 a month, and a penny a share. So you'll be able to trade unlimited amounts of stocks for that price. So there's a bunch of different models, but they're very cost effective, as you probably can can hear. It's the lowest cost execution on the US markets in the world. Anybody?
Okay, a big round of applause for Carlo Macchi. And I believe, ladies